Police and prosecutors in Chicago laid out their case today against Jussie Smollett, detailing their evidence day by day, minute by minute, of what they allege was an orchestrated attack. Joining me now is Chicago Mayor Rahm Emanuel. Mayor Emanuel, I appreciate you joining us. I want to play this, the superintendent, Eddie Johnson, today, and then we'll discuss. Here it is.
The stunt was orchestrated by Smollett because he was dissatisfied with his salary. So he concocted a story about being attacked. Now, our city has problems. We know that. We have problems that have affected people from all walks of life, and we know that. But to put the national spotlight on Chicago for something that is both egregious and untrue is simply shameful.
So, Mayor, the superintendent was clearly disgusted and emotional talking about this alleged hoax. How did you feel watching him talk about Chicago?
Well, he's exactly right. And the Chicago I know, as I said earlier today, across our city in 77 different neighborhoods, there are people that have signs in their front door, lawn, on their windows, that say, hate has no home here. And to use Chicago in that way is not true to who we are as a city. Whether because of sexual orientation, race, faith, we have 140 languages spoken in our public schools. We are a welcoming city of all types of people. And I'm upset about what he said about the city and the way he used the city. But more importantly, and every city has challenges to work on, let me say something about our city. That is, our police officers took this as a very serious hate crime, and they dedicated the resources to deal with it as a hate crime. But then you literally put doubt, not only about the city, but more, and also, in addition, what about the person that's in the workplace facing discrimination and racial discrimination?
Right.
What about the young man who is dealing with his own sexual orientation and is attacked for it in high school or in some school, who's now going to doubt whether people are going to believe him? You have put all those real stories at risk for your fake story. That is not right. That is not right for Chicago. That is not right for what kind of city we are, because I know this city. I'm going to tell you an example of it. About 3 months ago, we were talking about our free community college program, and the young man at a breakfast that introduced me is the son of a Syrian immigrant who fled the violence of Syria to introduce a Jewish mayor who's the grandson of an individual that came to Chicago fleeing the violence of Eastern Europe 100 years ago. And no other city can you have an immigrant child who is now going to college because of the same aspirations, introduce of a different faith, a Muslim, introduce a Jewish mayor who's a grandson of an immigrant. That is the city I know. That is the city that actually loves people because they love the city, they care in our common humanity. And he put that all at risk for himself.
Mayor.
He put the idea of somebody facing, yes?
I don't normally see you get this emotional. Why is that?
Well, you haven't, because it's, look, I was, you know, my mother started her career and started us in politics, working on Congress on racial equality in Chicago. I'm the son and the grandson of an immigrant. I saw when Pittsburgh had a synagogue and people die, people of all faiths in my city came together, Muslim, Christian, and Jew, because an attack on one faith is an attack on all faith and all people of all faith. That is the Chicago I know. And for, you know, if you want to get paid more, get an agent. But don't use your sexual orientation, don't use your race, and have everybody's sympathies come to you, and it turns out it was none of that was true. And some young man in school is going to be attacked. Somebody at work is going to face discrimination. And everybody now is going to have two doubts about whether that is true.
You mentioned the police department. And I just want to go through what the superintendent and others laid out in painstaking detail. The police work that went into piecing together, everything that happened. Listen to this and then we'll discuss.
We interviewed over 100 individuals in a canvas of the area and a follow-up canvas as our investigation expanded.
Defendant Smollett further detailed that he wanted Abel to attack him, but not hurt him too badly, and to give him a chance to appear to fight back. Defendant Smollett also included that he wanted Ola to place a rope around his neck, pour gasoline on him, and yell, "This is MAGA country."
I believe that Mr. Smollett wanted it on camera, but unfortunately that particular camera wasn't pointing in that direction.
The stage attack lasted 45 seconds, and it was just outside the view of the desired nearby camera that Smollett had pointed out to the brothers approximately 15 hours earlier.
We have the check that he used to pay them. So the $3,500 was for the two of them in total, and then $500 upon return.
Mayor, there's no mistaking it. They did an amazing job. I don't think Smollett, and I wonder what how you feel about this, if he knew what he was up against, if he knew, and I know I work there. Chicago is one of the most surveilled cities in the nation, really started the trend with the cams all over the city and so on. They did an amazing job. Did he know what he was up against?
That's a question you got to ask him and his attorneys. But our police department and all the businesses did a fabulous job. They worked tirelessly to get to the bottom and get the facts that happened here. And what he knows or didn't know, that's something only he can answer. I do want to do one other thing. I'm proud of the police department, I'm proud of the city. I also know the true character of the city. And what he said happened is not the character of our city or the people that make it up. Now, that said, we have our problems. We're going to work on solving them. I would just say one other cautionary note, Don. I think the national media, I think national politicians, they need to take a step back. And they need to think about this moment. They need to think about other moments and think about how we approach stories going forward. Because you and I know that the moment this was said, everybody rushed to judgment about the veracity of it. And it didn't add up to a lot of us that live in Chicago. Our officers pursued it as if it were the truth and came to the truth or the facts as they were laid out. I hope one of the things that we all come out of this is learning that before we rush to judgment, we should take a pause, get the facts. And that's not just on the media, although that's a part of it. That's also on national politicians. They jump to a conclusion about what was true and not true at the time, which is also why I'm upset. Because at some point, somebody in the future who is a victim of an attack because of their sexual orientation, or a victim because of their attack because of their faith, or a victim because of their race, will not be believed, but when they should be heard and trusted for what has happened to them. And this puts that at risk. Yeah. And that, to me, is what is also upsetting.
Here, this is what the president tweeted about this. He said, "Jussie Smollett, what about MAGA and the tens of millions of people you insulted with your racist and dangerous comments?" And then he did a hashtag MAGA. Listen, you talked about national politicians. He is the biggest national politician, the leader of the free world, really. The country is incredibly divided right now. We're debating blackface scandals, protests by black football players, Nazis marching in Charlottesville. Emotions are really raw right now. Was he taking advantage, Jussie Smollett, meaning of the divides in our society, making matters worse?
Well, let me say one thing about President Trump. You know, for all of us who are battling bigotry, its consequences, this is also a president that draw a moral equivalency of what happened in Virginia between bigots and those fighting bigotry. And there is not the same moral equivalency. So when it comes to having a lecture, I just like to remind the president of what he said when things were happening in Virginia, which really drew a moral equivalency, and there isn't. There's a real difference because those who advocate and promote bigotry and those who confront it head on.
So before I let you go, what's your message to the people of Chicago right now? You've spoken, you said you'd have to bite your tongue when it comes to Jussie Smollett. What do you say to the citizens of Chicago?
Well, first of all, a lot of people through this last 3 weeks in Chicago, they said this didn't add up. The facts that they know it, literally in the middle of the night at 2:30 in the morning on Lower Wacker, somebody going out at 2:30 in the morning when it's basically almost the Arctic freeze, you could have done Uber Foods if you wanted. That you're going to go there, they're waiting for you, and you did this in the middle of downtown, none of that made sense. But in the bigger thing, And Don, if you were in Chicago, you would see what I see when I drive all over the city. Literally in windows of all walks of life in 77 different neighborhoods, on front lawns, hate has no home. That's the character of the people of the city of Chicago. That is who we are. We have our challenges, but we work together to solve them and address them.
Mayor Emanuel, thank you so much. I appreciate your time.
Thanks, Don.